actress Stormy Daniels taking a stand against defendant Trump for the first time ever. She's a key witness in this trial, and his lawyers have argued that she's lying, that there would be no validity to her story or her potential history with Trump. So prosecutors had an important goal here today, showing the jury that she's believable, that she's telling the truth, that the facts are on her side. And while defendant Trump is not on trial for lying about the underlying encounter, that itself would not be a crime and is not charged, they want to use, the DA, this testimony to show that this was part of the first of many lies by Trump, some of which, prosecutors argue, are crimes. This is Daniels' first ever time under oath in this kind of proceeding, her chance to be heard in a legal process that has spanned years and that has often said had involved many claims about her at the center of this scandal.
Donald Trump's personal attorney paid a porn star named Stormy Daniels to keep quiet about her alleged relationship with the Republican candidate for president.
The former president accused of paying $130,000 in hush money to Stormy Daniels.
Daniels, of course, is at the center of this entire case.
Stormy Daniels became a household name for shaking the corridors of power with.
Everybody wants to hear what Stormy Daniels will say.
Riveting, bombshell, sometimes icky testimony from the woman at the heart of the first ever criminal trial of an American ex-president.
As our colleague Nicole put it there, riveting, bombshell, and icky all at once. The world knows Donald Trump's history with Daniels is what catapulted the payments that led to this trial. One question for the jury today is simply who is telling the truth about that encounter? Daniels finally speaking out as Trump looked on today. We have those sketches and many reporters inside the room who viewed him as having a sour expression. Today's testimony grew heated at times, with the judge getting angry and Stormy Daniels raising her voice to the degree that it was described as yelling, or almost yelling. Now, Daniels testified she didn't care about the money per se, but she wanted to get that payment deal done. If that is familiar, it is a view she shared many years back when the story broke in 2018.
Was it hush money to stay silent?
Yes. The story was coming out again. I was concerned for my family and their safety.
I think some people watching this are going to doubt that you entered into this negotiation because you fear for your safety. They're going to think that you saw an opportunity.
I think the fact that I didn't even negotiate, I just quickly said yes to this very, you know, strict contract, and what most people will agree with me, extremely low number, is all the proof I need.
That is how Daniels put it then. And there is this balance in the money side that was on display today, because on the one hand, she popped back up with her lawyer and took the money. On the other hand, it took the money for silence. On the other hand, there is the kind of view or feeling that there was a lot of other dirty work going on, both during the rushed October payment, but also afterward. And again, this is a business fraud and campaign case, so the after period could matter a lot. And Daniel says Trump benefited from the 2016 deal, and that she understood his lawyer, Michael Cohen, to be acting on his behalf. Now, her view does not settle the matter. Other witnesses could be called and insist Trump was out of the loop. That's what his lawyers have tried to say. But again, the jury is hearing her view as the key participant, and they are hearing a lot more people and a lot more evidence suggesting that Trump was involved in this and that it all just was sort of cooked up without him. Daniels recounts the last time she saw Trump was in 2007, and he seemed blasé then about keeping their history secret. This exchange matters again because it builds on the story that the DA's team has been telling, that it was only the election year, 2016, that made Trump suddenly change his approach. He didn't appear to be concerned about people finding out then, Daniels says under oath today. Now, she was very explicit on the stand, and that included at times clearly offering more than that was asked. And remember, this is not just some random conversation or dinner party chatter. This is a very narrow proceeding. I've told you how in some other days of the court, they've had People from C-SPAN come in because they couldn't get to an agreement about what to be stipulating. And witnesses are supposed to respond to questions, not just give speeches. And this was the most potentially sensitive witness we're going to hear in the whole trial. So at one point, for example, Daniels was detailing the feelings she had, her hands shaking, she just wanted to leave. And while that may be her honest view, I'm not saying it's not true, I am saying that the judge at times thought she was going farther than what was right for the evidentiary testimony that they'd agreed upon. Now, as a matter of fairness, remember, the case is about business fraud in the campaign. It is not about adjudicating the encounter itself. Now, I would remind you, Trump's lawyers have been chided on other days for what they and their client has said or done, but today we saw something a little different. The judge, quote, angry with prosecutors, that's from one of our write-ups of our people watching, over Daniel's testimony, and directing prosecutors to avoid what was clearly, quote, unnecessary detail, because we know the judge's view was some of that would have no legal point and could even be prejudicial. The judge siding with Trump's lawyers on that point, sustaining multiple objections by the Trump defense. And they were hammering prosecutors, arguing that they said the only reason the government's asking some of these very personal questions, aside from pure embarrassment, is to, quote, inflame this jury. And the judge clearly understood that concern and tried to narrow prosecutors or sustain the objections, which again means that you don't just keep going down that road of questioning. The judge also rejected a bigger reach by the Trump lawyers when they requested that they basically toss or stop the whole case with a mistrial motion. Now, there were things that would have been better left unsaid. The judge agreed in part with the logic there and said Daniels was a little difficult to control, but that didn't get to the point, quote, where a mistrial would be warranted. Now, prosecutors did try to talk to Daniels about keeping her answers focused or short. There was also a tense cross-exam from the Trump attorney who asked, am I correct, you hate President Trump? To which she said, yes, and you wanted to go to jail. Daniels replied, I want him to be held accountable. The idea there is to do something that we're going to see with both Daniels and other witnesses like Michael Cohen, which is to paint them as somehow so vindictive, so angry, that they're less than truthful. Remember, we talk about free speech and First Amendment and your right to your views and opinions. These witnesses could have views of Trump, just like they could vote for or against him. But in the court of law, they are not supposed to let those views infect or distort their actual under oath testimony about facts, about what did or didn't happen. And so the Trump lawyers may have been onto something here. We're going to talk about that with our guests tonight, about whether that could affect the jury at all, how credible they see even a very key witness like Stormy Daniels. They also asked about a goal of, quote, extorting Trump. So that's a way to kind of push that defense, but Daniels resisted that. You can see the exchange here. You were looking to extort money from President Trump, right? Asked the lawyer, Stormy Daniels. False. Trump lawyers continues. Well, that's what you did, right? False, Daniels says. This is one of the most explosive and emotional days we've seen in this trial yet. And it is clearly on the line. And when I say on the line, I don't mean in some sort of made-up observation. I mean under the rules of the court. And the reason the judge had to actually limit some of the testimony is that it was at, on, or sometimes over the line of how much of this was just stuff that sounds bad about Trump. And it might be true and sound bad, but that's not enough to convict. And what was necessary to show, according to the DA, that they have a truthful witness who had this encounter and was paid off for it. And there was a cover-up, and it was a campaign crime.